There are about 125 types of rocket engines produced in the world. But it's all crushed by the production speed of what SpaceX do with their Raptor engine, and how SpaceX made crazy manufacturing of Raptor engine, and smashing the whole rocket industry. Let's find out in the video. First of all, how amazing is the SpaceX Raptor 2 production rate, and what's Elon's plan at this point? Numerous Raptor 2 engines are now being put through their paces, at SpaceX Test Center in McGregor, involving static fire testing, at the 5 test bays ahead of the evolved engine being shipped to Starbase, to be involved in future launches. A senior NASA official said this week that SpaceX has done very well in working toward the development of a vehicle to land humans on the surface of the moon, taking steps to address two of the space agency's biggest concerns. NASA selected SpaceX and Starship for its human landing system in April 2021. In some ways, this was the riskiest choice of NASA's options, because Starship is a very large and technically advanced vehicle. However, because of the company's self-investment of billions of dollars into the project, SpaceX submitted the lowest bid, and from its previous work with SpaceX, NASA had confidence that the company would ultimately deliver. Two of NASA's biggest technological development concerns were the new Raptor rocket engine and the transfer and storage of liquid oxygen and methane propellant in orbit, said Mark Karasich. NASA's deputy associate administrator who oversees the development of Artemis missions to the moon. During a subcommittee meeting of NASA's advisory council on Monday, however, Karasich said SpaceX has made substantial progress in both areas. On Raptor, the Raptor rocket engine is crucial to Starship's success. 33 of these Raptor 2 engines power the Super Heavy booster that serves as the vehicle's first stage, and 6 more are used by the Starship upper stage. For a successful lunar mission, these engines will need to relight successfully on the surface of the moon to carry astronauts back to orbit inside Starship. If the engines fail, the astronauts will probably die. SpaceX has moved very quickly on development, Karasich said about Raptor. We've seen them manufacture what was called Raptor 1.0. They have since upgraded to Raptor 2.0, that first of all increases performance and thrust and secondly reduces the amount of parts. Reducing the amount of time to manufacture and test. They build these things very fast. Their goal was 7 engines a week, and they hit that about a quarter ago. So they are now building 7 engines a week. Elon Musk's plan in the future will definitely blow your mind. The company's building new cutting-edge SpaceX factory located at the company's expansive McGregor, Texas area. This will focus on volume production of Raptor 2. While California factory will make the Raptor vacuum and new experimental designs, he said by volume production I mean 2 to 4 engines per day. That's super high volume for big rocket engines, but low volume by automotive standards, Musk added. Long term, he felt that SpaceX targeted to manufacture at roughly 8,100 to 1,000 engines per year. That's about what's needed over 10 years, to create the fleet to build a self-sustaining city on Mars. City itself probably takes roughly 20 years, so hopefully it's all built by 2050, says Musk. Actually, SpaceX Raptor 1 was an impossibility for the entire rocket industry, when they could produce a Raptor engine every 24 hours. But now let's imagine the speed of Raptor 2 at 4 per day. Just say, wow. With such a rapid growth rate, SpaceX Raptor 2 is indeed becoming the leader. So how slow is the growth of the others? With just a single high-volume variant required, Raptor 2 production could be extraordinarily efficient and would easily outpace any other large liquid engine production in history at 800 to 1,000 engines completed each year. To put this into perspective, the Raptor 2 rocket engine produces approximately 510,000 pounds of thrust. This is almost identical to the amount of thrust produced by the RS-25 engine that will be used to power NASA's Space Launch System rocket. This engine was designed and developed by Rocketdyne in the 1970s for the Space Shuttle program, and the company has decades of experience manufacturing them. In 2015, NASA gave Aerojet Rocketdyne a contract worth $1.16 billion to restart the production line for the RS-25 engine. Again, that was money just to re-establish manufacturing facilities, not actually build the engines. NASA is paying more than $100 million for each of those. With this startup funding, the goal was for Aerojet Rocketdyne to produce 4 of these engines per year. Karasich said that as it builds and tests Raptors, SpaceX is rapidly iterating on these processes and producing higher quality engines. SpaceX is also working toward demonstrations of the storage and transfer of cryogenic propellants in space. The liquid oxygen and methane used by Starship to fly to and land on other worlds. This, by the way, is very high on their top risk list, Karasich said of cryogenic fuel management. There is a thorough ground test program and, more importantly, a thorough in-space propellant transfer and also measurement of boil-off in-space test plan. During Artemis moon missions, SpaceX will launch the lunar lander version of its Starship into low Earth orbit, where it will rendezvous with a depot. This propellant depot will be optimized to prevent the boil-off of cryogenic fuels in space. Yes, space is very cold, but when exposed to sunlight, objects in space can get very hot regardless. SpaceX plans to load this depot with propellant prior to the launch of a lunar Starship with a tanker form of the vehicle. Karasich was not specific but said it would require, relatively speaking, quite a few tanker flights to provide enough fuel for a Starship to the moon mission. Karasich said SpaceX is presently targeting early December for a test flight of Starship and Super Heavy. Although this timeline is dependent upon a number of factors, including a full 33-engine static fire test of Super Heavy, an FAA launch license, and final preparation of ground systems at SpaceX's Starbase launch facility in South Texas. After this initial test flight, Karasich said NASA is tracking three additional flight tests of Starship for fueling demonstrations. The second test, Karasich said, will entail a tank-to-tank transfer of propellant, followed by a Starship-to-Starship transfer of propellant. To a complete fueling of Starship from a depot, and a long-duration flight to mimic the in-space time of a lunar mission. SpaceX plans to keep its low-Earth orbit propellant depots, topped off with fuel for missions other than Artemis, Karasich added. So it's not like every time we go to the moon we're going to start with an empty depot, he said. Depending on how well SpaceX's in-flight demonstrations go, Karasich said the nominal target for an uncrewed test flight of Starship to the surface of the moon and back up to orbit around the moon is toward the end of 2024. If this is successful, it would set the stage for the Artemis 3 mission, carrying NASA astronauts down to the moon. Thanks for watching this video and it's a super interesting topic. If you like this to make sure you can subscribe. If you have any crazy idea what we should cover in next video, please comment it below, and we will see if we can get the, and thanks again for watching and goodbye.